But it's up to us to learn it, understand it, and apply it.
Because being broke is just a state of mind.
Credit is an asset. I'm finna show you why it's an asset.
When we get up in the habits of buying assets, our assets pay for our expenses.
These are various chips I've gotten in 12 months for one house.
It's a mindset. We change the way we think. The credit world is gonna change for you. Because now you're empowered with information and strategies to achieve whatever it is you're trying to accomplish.
I am a resource. I know y'all. Y'all know me. Reach out to me.
Oh, that's great. That's great.
You know what time it is. Disclaimer. I am not an attorney, nor do I offer or give legal advice. So please understand that all information that we talk about in any of my webinars are strictly information and educational purposes. And most of it is just personal experiences with things anyway. So please understand, this is not legal advice. And may you be blessed on your journey to find your power within these laws. Peace and blessings. All right, so now you see I have FDIC Securitization credit card hit here. We're going to go to their website. You see this is the FDIC, it's their website. And to the top of this, we are on the Credit Card Securitization Manual. And this is Chapter 2, Securitization Transaction Overview. Now, what I'm about to show you should be very, very troubling. But also, it should also be evidence so you can really understand what's really going on with these banks. All right, here we go. The Securitization Transaction Overview. Introduction. This chapter provides a basic overview of credit card securitization. Subsequent chapters go into more detail on the various concepts discussed here. Asset-backed securities, which is referred to as ABS, are bonds backed by financial assets, such as auto loans, mobile home loans, and credit card loans, and student loans. Now, let's just stop right there. ABSs are bonds that are backed by financial assets. So, the financial assets are auto loans, mobile home loans, credit card loans, and student loans. Assets. Okay, these are our liabilities, but they're assets to the bank. Did the bank tell you that you were providing them an asset? Well, let's keep reading. In the case of credit card asset-backed securities, ABS, the bonds, referred to as certificates or ABS in this document, are backed by credit card receivables. Credit card receivables, which in turn our payments that we make on these credit cards. Okay. While the process of securitizing loans has been around for over 30 years, the securitization of credit card receivables first began in 1987. So they just started securitizing credit cards in 1987. Since then, the process and structure have evolved significantly. I bet it has. The credit card securitizations currently represent the primary funding vehicles for unsecured revolving consumer credit. Similar to mortgage and other asset securitizations, y'all, the financial institution that originates the credit card receivables sells a group of these receivables to who? A trust. The trust then creates and sells certificates backed by the credit card receivables, which is our payments, to investors, which are predominantly institutional investors. Very few credit card ABSs are marked to retail customers, primarily due to the complex nature of the transactions and the need to continually monitor various performance indices on the underlying receivables. The underlying credit card receivables generate income to support the interest payments on the certificates. So they're issuing these certificates to the investors, right? Our payments are the receivables, and then they're turning around and giving that money to someone else who gave them some money for what? The contracts, right? Or their securitized contracts that they're calling bonds, right? Because they're backed by financial assets such as the auto loans, mobile loans, credit card loans, and student loans. Did they tell you that you were backing their assets in the contracts that you signed? Did they give you that disclosure letting you know that you were going to be a primary investor to a security that was going to be given to another investor? That's not disclosure. Well, let's keep reading the basic setup. Now they're going to break it down to us even more. Exhibit A depicts a basic setup for a securitization. The securitization is created when the financial institution, originator slash transferor slash seller slash sponsor has accumulated a significant volume of credit card receivables, originated or purchased, and transfers these receivables to a wholly owned bankruptcy remote, which is called Special Purpose Entity, a SPE, which then transfers the receivables to a securitization vehicle, typically a QSPE trust. The trust then packages the receivables and issues investor certificates sold to investors and trust certificates retained by the transferor or affiliate. Proceeds from the sale of the investor certificates go to the trust. To the trust? Shouldn't it go back to the consumers? The trust in turn pays the financial institution, which is the seller, for the purchase of the underlying credit card receivables. Sounds like once they pay the seller, that means everybody's debt should be given, because now the seller, which is the bank, and in turn sends you up for the loan, now they receive payment. But they don't tell us that, and we're still making payments, which is technically, isn't that an overpayment? They're getting like they're getting interest from us, right? The trust then packages the receivables and issues investor certificates sold to investors and trust certificates retained by the transfer or affiliates. Proceeds from the sale of the investor certificates goes to the trust. The trust in turn pays the financial institution, which is the seller, for the purchase of the underlying credit card receivables. The investor certificates noted in Exhibit A, which is right here, are typically issued with a senior slash subordinate structure. The seller slash originator often retains the bottom or must subordinated pieces. The trust certificates are also referred to as transfers interest, seller's certificate, or seller's interest. Exhibit A, we have right here this top box, the originator slash seller. Sponsor slash transfer goes down to the wholly owned bankruptcy remote SPE. Then that goes to the QSPE transfer issuer. Then over to the left, we got the servicing. At the bottom, we have investor certificate, security slash bonds notes purchased by the investors. And to the right, we have the seller interest retained by transfer or an affiliate. Y'all notice who's not in this model here, the consumer. Rather than setting up a new trust for each securitization issued, most credit card companies use a single master trust for multiple issues, as illustrated in Exhibit B. A master trust is set up to allow for receivables to be added to the trust over time and to issue multiple series of certificates identified by specific issue dates, all backed by a single pool of credit card receivables in the master trust. The cash flow generated from all the receivables in the master trust is used to fund debt service payments on each series. As such, each series has an undivided interest in the receivables in the master trust. Now here's Exhibit B. We got the master trust right here. Right to the left, we have collectively the investor certificate holders. Then they break that down to more subcategories. Then they break that down into separate classes. While we have back up here at the top, the seller's interest is this oval shape right here. Okay. The purpose of SPE and QSPE master trust. SPEs and QSPE master trust are established to isolate transferred financial assets beyond the reach of the transferor and its creditors. Even in the event of bankruptcy of the transferor, in order for the transaction to be treated as a sale, the transferor must surrender control over the assets transferred and receive consideration or compensation for the transferred assets. Now let's stop right here. Where is the consumer's consideration or compensation for the issued assets? Control is considered to be surrounded only if all of the following three conditions are met. The assets have been legally isolated. The transferee has the ability to pledge or exchange the assets. The transferor otherwise no longer maintains effective control over the assets. These control requirements are discussed in greater detail in the accounting chapter. In addition, the FDIC adopted a final rule on the treatment of securitization and participations following the FDIC's appointment as conservator or receiver, which directly relates to the legal isolation concept. Examiners can review this document to gain a greater insight into the FDIC's position regarding this isolation test. So keep in mind where this is coming from. This is a manual, y'all. This is a breakdown of instructions on what's going on behind the scenes that the consumer is not aware of. So if the consumer is not aware of this type of information, and this type of information might have affected the consumer's decision in signing that contract, whether it was a car loan, mortgage, credit card, etc., and they did not disclose this information to you, remember, I've done other videos. What does that constitute? Kind of sounds like unfair and deceptive practices to me, right? So here's the proof of your claim on how they defrauded you by just reading this document, understanding what's going on, and using this as evidence in a case or a petition against these clowns, right? So let's keep going on with the transaction. In a credit card securitization transaction, only the receivables are sold, not the accounts that generate the receivable, okay? The financial institutions retain legal ownership of the credit card accounts and can continue to change the terms on the accounts, which we know that they love to do. Accounts corresponding to securitized loans are typically referred to as the designated accounts. Footnote. Or sometimes trust accounts. The initial outstanding balances on the designated accounts are sold to the trust, as are the rights to any new charges on the designated accounts. Subsequently, as cardholder purchase activity generates more receivables on the designated accounts, these new receivables are purchased by the trust from the originating institution / seller / transferor. The trust uses the monthly principal payments received from the cardholders to acquire these new charges or receivables. When the securitization is initially set up, the originating institution slash seller adds sufficient receivables to support the principal balance of the certificates plus an additional amount, which is the seller's interest, that serves to absorb fluctuation in the outstanding balance of the receivables. The originating institution-sized seller will make subsequent additions to the trust in order to keep the seller's interest at the required level. Seller's interest. The seller's interest, also referred to as transferor's certificate or a seller's certificate, represents ownership interest in the trust assets that have not been allocated to any investor certificates holder's interest. Seller's interest represents credit card receivables transferred to the securitization vehicle but not pledged to back any specific certificates. As a result, the relationship between the seller's interest and the investor certificate is pariapostal. If I pronounce that right, meaning the holders of the investor certificates and the holder of the seller's interest have the same priority on claims on the underlying collateral. The size of the seller's interest is determined by the rating agencies and serves two primary purposes. First, it absorbs fluctuation in the outstanding principal's balances of the designated accounts. Since investor certificates are issued in fixed principal amounts, the seller's interest exists to ensure that there will be sufficient collateral available to support the investor certificates, particularly since cardholder seasonal spending patterns cause balances to fluctuate, and in some months, principal payments may exceed new charges on the cards. Second, it is available to ensure sufficient receivables exist following non-cash deductions in the balances, which is called dilution, due to charge reversals, such as merchandise returns, disputes, and fraudulent charges. Charge-offs are typically shared pro rata between the seller's interest and the investor certificates. The seller's interest is not always certificated, as the term seller certificate or transfer certificate often implies. In the past, institutions have stated that since the seller's interest represents the seller certificates, it should be carried in the investment portfolio versus the loan portfolio, thereby eliminating the need for an allowance for loan and lease losses, all ALLL, against the seller's interest. However, the seller's interest piece does not represent a sale or financing since no proceeds were received for the transferred assets. Instead, the seller received an interest in the transferred assets, so did the consumer who issued them, and this interest should be reflected in the loan category of the financial institution's books. All right, now let's look at this fast little paragraph. I'm not going to read this because I don't want this video to be too long. This is probably going to be one of my longest, but this is going to be probably one of the best. All right, let's go break down this cash flow and structures. Credit card securitizations differ from ABS since the underlying credit card receivables have a relatively short life, typically 8 to 10 months, supporting the outstanding certificates, which typically have 3, 5, or 10-year maturities. As a result of this maturity mismatch, each series issued out of the master trust is structured to have a revolving period and a controlled amortization period or controlled accumulation period. During the revolving period, The cardholders make monthly principal and interest payments to the servicer. The servicer deposits the payments into two separate collection accounts, one for the principal and one for the finance charges. The trust expenses are paid, including interest payments on the investor certificates, from the finance charge account. The new receivables generated by the designated accounts are purchased from the originating institution / seller and funds from the principal account. The revolving period is for a predetermined period of time that is established at the time the series, often referred to as the deal, is structured. Following the revolving period, there is controlled amortization or accumulation period. During the controlled amortization period, the principal collections are used to pay down the outstanding principal amount of the investor certificates. During controlled accumulation, the principal payments collected are deposited into the trust account and reinvested in short-term investments. These short-term investments become the collateral for the outstanding investor certificates and increase as principal payments are received from the cardholders until the investment equals the amount of the outstanding investor certificates in the maturing series. The investments mature at the same time, allowing the trustee to make a bullet payment to all the investment certificate holders. Most credit card ABS are structured using controlled accumulation and bullet payments. Since the designated pool of accounts remain part of the trust, the seller's interest grows during the amortization or accumulation phase. This is what is meant by the commonly used phrase, receivables come back on the books. The financial institution or seller does not actually bring the previous sold receivables on the books when the investor certificates mature or during the accumulation period. Instead, as noted, the principal payments received on the sold receivables are accumulated, which is invested, and ultimately used to pay off the outstanding investor certificates, while the new charges incurred on the designated accounts during the accumulation period become the seller's interest, since they are no longer collateral for the investor certificates and as such are reported as loans on the bank's books. Now, people, if this doesn't move you, I don't know what should, and I'm going to leave you to ponder and marinate on that. Peace and prosperity.